it was a couple weeks ago that came onto my heart, and I didn't even know Pastor was going to, but he mentioned it two Sundays ago that he wanted to go through witnessing. I hope I don't steal his ideas or vice versa, but there's many verses, as we know, about witnessing. I'm not going to cover them all this morning, but about preaching last weekend and about giving your testimony or even just evangelizing for the Lord. Really, I've been seeing it through not just the Old Testament. I just got into Matthew, and you can see the little snippets of each Bible book has different witnesses for the Lord. And I hope I can draw a couple of those out and just highlight a couple that were highlighted to me, and I think were important to in my life that I hope are important to yours. So I'd like to go for the first mention, and we go all the way to Genesis 31. I'm going to keep the Bible read into congregation today. So I'm going to have Bert go first to 31, 43 through 45. And pray for our morning.
41 to 45?
Yes, 43.
And Laban answered and said unto Jacob, these daughters are my daughters, and these children are my children, and these cattle are my cattle. All that thou seest is mine. What can I do this day unto these my daughters, or unto their children, which they have borne? Now therefore, come thou, let us make a covenant, I and thou, and let it be for witness between me and thee. Jacob took a stone and set it up for a pillar. Lord, thank you for your word. Lord, thank you for the opportunity to come and hear it taught, hear it preached and teach it later, the opportunity to sing together and pour praises to you. Congregation, you worthy. Lord, pray that you be with Dave and Ken this morning. Lord, pray that you fill them with the Spirit, give them what you have us to have. Lord, pray that you help both of them, especially Ken. Lord, to be Tom, because he's got a friendly crowd, and it's Lord, in you anyway. And Lord, help us be open to what your Spirit has to say for you, Lord. Pray in Jesus' name.
So a few weeks ago, I had jury duty, which was fun, but there was also witnesses that they used on the stand. It was either from personal witnessing, or it was from a third-party witness as well. They're not subject to either, but as we see in Genesis, is that it was a witness for a covenant. Our ultimate covenant is Jesus Christ. So I understand where we are, and it's a covenant, and they make it many times throughout the Old Testament. They do it for the purpose of between land. It could be, it's for cattle. But they're showing being a witness up in the open for each other. You are a witness in a traffic accident. You can be a witness in an altercation that you might see. You're a third party, so our ultimate witness, our ultimate third party is Jesus Christ. It's that we're bearing witness, as we'll see later as we go through. We're going to bear witness for Jesus Christ. Another good place we're going today is Job 16. Brother Paul, can I have you read 16, 13 through 22?
Yes, sir. All right. His archers compass me around about. He cleaveth my reins asunder, and doth not spare. He poureth out my gall upon the ground. He breaketh me with breach upon breach. He runneth upon me like a giant. I have showed sackcloth unto my skin, and defiled my horn with dust. My face is foul with weeping, and on my eyelids is a shadow of death. Not for any injustice in my hands, also my prayer is pure. O earth, cover not thou my blood, and let my cry have no place. Also now, behold, my witness is in heaven, and my record is on high. My friends scorn me, but my eye pours out tears unto God. Oh, that one might plead for a man with God, as a man pleaded for his neighbor. When a few years are come, then I shall go, away whence I shall not return.
So in this passage, I mean, you're seeing that Job is pretty down in his life. He's pretty sorrowful. He breaketh, in verse 14, he breaketh me with a breach upon breach. He runs upon me like a giant. I mean, he's trodden down. He's hurt. He's broke. I mean, to get your pride down, God has to break you. He has in my life. So, I mean, you can see throughout Job's life. I understand where we are, Old Testament again. We'll get into some New Testament in due time. But showing different books, and you can see the different witnesses that Job, I mean, it's clear throughout is that he has to break Job down to really get him a witness. Maybe it's a witness to those three friends. Maybe it's a witness to his mother. I mean, sorry, to his wife. You're chanting your mother sometimes. he's bearing witness. He is a witness for showing what God is doing in his life, you know, taking his children away, bringing him down very, very low, giving him sickness, giving him many different things to really trot him down and actually use him for the glory of God. Verse 19, it says, behold, my witness is in heaven, my record is on high. Amazing verse. He doesn't know. It's Old Testament, he doesn't know what he's actually saying, but it's a great cross-reference in Romans 8:34. Mm-hmm. Who is he that condemneth? It is Christ that died, yea, rather, that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who so much maketh intercession for us. Mm-hmm. Who's that man that makes intercession for us? Mm-hmm. That's Jesus Christ. Job didn't know it then, but we have that intercession. We now have that intercession between God and man. That's Jesus Christ. He bore our sin on that cross so that we can have that intercession. And he took that ultimate sacrifice for us. Let's go over to John 1. And I was saying before, as we were bearing witnesses,
born not of blood nor of the will of the flesh, arise, saying, this was he of whom I spake, he that cometh after me is preferred before him, he was before him. And of his fullness have all we received, and grace for grace. For the law was given by Moses, and grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. No man hath seen God at any time, the only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father.
Very well-known passage, very well-known area, and we can preach on this line by line, and it's amazing. But I do want to highlight a couple of different things just going on with the witnessing part, is that in verse 7, the same came for a witness, to bear witness of the light. So John was bearing witness of the true light, it's capital L for light, that all men through him might believe. So he's trying to, what we are trying to do in our lives is that we're trying to go out and bear witness for the true light. We have the light in us. We have that Holy Spirit within us, but we're trying to bear that light within us to shine much brighter so that we're bearing witness of the light, the true light. Verse 8, he was not that light, talking about John, but was sent to bear witness of the light to now further agree with verse 7. Verse 11, he came unto his own, and his own received him not. We used that a couple times this morning, is that he came unto his own, the Jews. Talk about Jesus Christ. And he came, even John, talking with his fellow brethren, preaching and teaching, and in and out of synagogues. Not all of them received it. Not everybody you speak to is going to receive it. On the street, not everybody is going to agree with what you have to say. Mm-hmm. Very, very, very seldom that you see another Christian out there, or you do see one, you're like, wow, there's another light. You're attracted to that. You know, it's like seeing a flash on a camera or something like that. But, oh wow, there are others out there. And then you ask them that, hey, can you take this track and give it to somebody? And there are some that do, and it's amazing. It's awesome. And they're like, yeah. Look, you're just bearing witness for that true light, and it's awesome. Good cross reference for verse 11 is 7:5. For neither did his brethren believe on him. His brethren didn't even believe. I mean, you're trying to talk about the true light of the world, and his own brethren didn't even. You're going to see that throughout your life, throughout this life, is that or even your family, your friends, people that are close to you, won't believe. I mean, they won't say they're atheists, or they won't say that they're, true believers. Oh, I believe there's a God, or I'm of this religion or that religion, but they just don't believe. It's unfortunate. Verse 18, no man hath seen God at any time. The only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father, he hath declared him. So no man has seen God, but only begotten Son, that is Jesus Christ. He bears witness for God. He is that third party for us that bear witness. Now, we've never seen Jesus Christ. We've never seen God the Father, but we know we can bear witness because of the testimonies of and the Holy Spirit within us, that we are bearing of that light. So let us answer the question, how do we witness for Jesus Christ? Or how do we, have the tools to witness for Jesus Christ? Let's go over to Luke 8. Very well-known passage.
City spake by a parable. The sower went out to sow his seed, and as he sowed, some fell by the wayside, it was trodden down, fowls of the air devoured it. Some fell upon a rock, and as soon as it was sprung up, it withered away because of lack of moisture. And some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprang up with it and choked it. Others fell on good ground, sprang up bare fruit 100-fold. When he had said these things, he cried, "He that hath ears to hear, let him hear." The disciples asked him, saying, "What might this parable be?" And he said unto you, "It is given to them the mysteries of the kingdom of God, to others in parables, that seeing they might not see, hear they may not understand."
No, I do want to continue it. I just want to make these points very well known, and this is how you see in your life of how you're going to give out the seed, you know, how you're going to give out the word, how you're going to give out the gospel. Is that verse 5, it fell by the wayside. So it went out and sowed the seed, and he sowed it and fell by the wayside, and it was trodden down, and the fowls of the air devoured it. I mean, it's been preached many, many times, this exact passage. You know, the devil comes around, you're going to give it out.
Absolutely.
And the devil comes around and just go, "You don't need that. You don't need Jesus Christ. You don't need eternal life."
Right.
I mean, you have everything in this world already. You have a car, you have a house, you have bills paid, you have air conditioning. You don't need God. God, what has God done for you?
Right.
Done a lot for you. Give the breath in your head, in your lungs. So, the devil comes around in verse 5. Funny how it's verse 5 too. Little sneak in there. No, at verse 6, and some fell by the rock upon a rock, and as it sprang up, it withered away because of lack of moisture. I mean, you can give the word out, but it's the next person to water that. You know, I may give a testimony out to my sister, and my wife could very well water it, or very well put a little fertilizer on. Fertilizer heats up and actually puts a little fire under the book. You never know what that's going to actually do, even by another person going after, you know, after you and watering that seed that's been put down. Verse 7, as some fell among the thorns, and the thorns sprang up, and it choked it. I mean, it could be other Christians. It could be other influences in this world, principalities and powers in this world. It's all around us. I mean, I've seen it in jail where I am, is that you give out the word, and you see other people come around, and it's like, you know, it's not cool to do, or it's not, you know, right of this world. Well, I know it's not right of this world. It's, you know, it's for a better purpose, for a better witness. It's not of this world. We're just passing through.
Mm-hmm.
So, verse 8, another fell on good ground, sprang up, bare fruit, 100-fold. And we had, when he had said these things, he cried, "He that hath ears to hear, let him hear." So, I mean, that's the ultimate seed going out. You know, we planted a small little garden for ours, and our tomato plants have just blossomed. I mean, they've done amazing. It's great to see. But it fell on good ground. We tilled that ground. We could have, we watered that ground. We did, you know, to cultivate it, to get it ready. But that's what, not our part, that's what God's doing to that person, that heart. You know, we pray on the street before we go out, said, prepare those hearts that do come in contact with us.
Right.
You know, already, I mean, maybe the night before, maybe the week before, maybe a couple days before, maybe the hour or the time just before you actually go out and preach, or just the time you go in and say something to, you know, a family member, or, you know, you go on an interview. You know, God help me. You know, or, you know, you're spinning out on 84. You want that little prayer just before, so that it's not you doing, it's not me up here, it's God, it's the Spirit, it's the Holy Ghost preaching through it. It has nothing to do with you. And you know, before I came up, just a little while, I mean, I got the nerve just walking up, and then you get here, and it's like, all the way. It's amazing. It's awesome. But that's how you do when you talk to a family member. It's the hardest thing to do. Like I said to John, you know, when we go back there again, is that it's hard to talk to your family, to your friends. They know you, your co-workers. It's not just a lifestyle advancement. You do have to open your mouth for them, as we'll see. Can I finish the parable? Verse 11, now the parable is this. The seed is the word of God. The So I didn't define it earlier, but I defined it by the word. So that was my fault. It's not that that defines it very well, it's that the seed is the word. So when you were talking about 4 through 10 that Pastor Rowe read, is that it is his word that's going out. And it's not our word, it's his word. Verse 12, by the wayside, those by the wayside are they that bear, that cometh the devil, and take away the word out of their hearts, lest they should believe and be saved. So we're saying before, you know, the devil comes around, just takes it away. Verse 13, they on the rock are they which, when they hear, receive the word with joy, they receive it. These have no root, so they're not in church, they haven't been discipled, which for a while believe, and in time of temptation fall away. So those times where you're not rooted and grounded in the word of God, you're not reading, you just go whichever way, by, you know, a wave or a wind, it's describing the Bible. In verse 14, and that which fell among thorns are they which, when they have heard, go forth and are choked by the cares and riches and pleasures of this life, and bring no fruit to perfection. So there are saved individuals that go forth and go out into the world, but they care about more of this world than really of eternal life and about the glory of God and about the, I think it would usually, it's a higher power, you know, how they use that in AA and RNA. But they're taking the pleasures of this world. Oh, let's go to an amusement park. Let's go to on a Sunday morning. It's like, why do you need a garden on Sunday morning? Why do you need to mow your grass on Sunday morning? Why do you need to go for your hike or whatever just to get away? You don't need to. You know where you're supposed to go. A lot of the society does. Or they plan things on Sundays. And you're like, sorry. There's things that we've turned down that are on Sundays. And we said, okay, we'll see you Saturday, but not Sunday. Mm-hmm. Those are the times that you actually commit to the Lord. You need to come here to hear the word preached, to get that, you know, rejuvenation so that you can make it through this week. You have the indwelling that gets more fertilization through the seed, which is the word. You know, you have a preacher that comes up here and preaches the word and gives it to you, you know, bell high. That's what we want. That's what we need. Verse 15, but on the ground are they which are in an honest and good heart, having heard the word, kept it, and bring forth fruit with patience. So I did a little comparison between before verse 11 and after verse 11. In verse 5 and verse 12, you can see the comparison, and that's 6 verses away. Verse 6 and verse 13, 6 verses away. So those are the ones that are on the bad ground of the thorns. Verse 7 and verse 14 are 7 verses away. So that's getting a little bit better. You're becoming a better saved person, but it's not the, you're not bearing that hundredfold, the fruit, bearing fruit of a hundredfold. Verse 8 through verse 15 is 7, and we know the number 7 is, you know, is more on God's level, not on the devil's level. So that, I saw that was pretty cool, is that, you know, how he breaks it up that way with the verses and stuff. Just a little something I saw. I thought it was pretty cool when I was reading through. In Mark 16:15, and he said unto them, go ye in all to the world and preach the gospel to every creature. So we're commissioned, not just here in Mark, and I know that's Old Testament, but to preach to every creature, to preach to every person, you know. I know there's another reference that I didn't write down, I forgot to grab. I know there's other places where to go in, onto the every place in the world and to preach. Colossians 1:23, continue in faith, grounded and settled, and be not moved away, so that deep root that you have from the hope of the gospel. So the gospel is the hope which ye have heard and which ye have preached to every creature which is under heaven, whereof I, Paul, am made a minister. So Paul is saying, I'm a minister of this gospel. Which gospel do you say? Well, it's the gospel of grace, the grace of God. You know, the gospel that we preach to every person. You know, it's not the tribulation gospel. It's not the gospel of the Old Testament. It's not the gospel of Abraham, which you're not saved in the Old Testament. As we've seen it through many, many times and through our doctrinal statement as well. You know, if you don't believe that, just like Pastor said up here, unfortunately, the door's right there. So let's ask the question, why do we serve God? You know, why do we want to serve God? It's not of a, you know, a duty that, you know, of going into the military that you signed up for. But after you're filled with the Holy Ghost, after you're filled with, you know, that salvation and that true light, you want to bear witness of that light. Well, he bought us with a price. 100%. 1 Corinthians 6:20. We also serve a risen Savior. 1 Corinthians 15. So let's go to 1 Corinthians 6.
After that, he was seen of about 500 brethren at once, of whom the
that Savior, why we serve God, because we're all with Christ. And he's risen again.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Muhammad, anybody else, any other religion that you see out in this world, none have risen from the grave.
Mm-hmm.
None have done it with the power of God.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's many different references we go to, that, you know, but I think this is the clear place that, you know, it's the gospel that we are preaching, that we are giving out, you know, that Christ died for our sins and rose again for the dead. That is absolutely huge. That's why we serve Him.
Mm-hmm.
You know, why else would we want to do this if, you know, we're just going to die just like Buddha Muhammad, or just like, you know, any other lost person in this world? What is it going to do? It's going to do nothing for us. Besides, the worm is going to eat us, and it's going to do nothing. So now we can move on to what tools we have. So the gospel that we see in 1 Corinthians 15, how do we give that out? Well, we give out tracts. So the first tract that ever was given to myself, which my wife does not know about this morning, is this one. What is that? This is the tract that she gave me when I was at work as a security officer. And all I did was put it in my pocket. Did nothing else. I thought I was being polite. And I sewed it away. I didn't know many more times she would witness to me, but I think I read through it. I don't remember, but it's I kept it because know where you came from, and it's in it. You know, I think it's that transition from when I was lost and now I am saved. You know, it was that she was bearing witness. She is the third party witness for Jesus Christ. You know, having that boldness to actually set one down and say, I care about you, I care about your soul. Not just, oh, you're another person, nothing like that, and oh, you can help me move. I have big muscles like falling before.
Married life, gotcha.
Yeah, very good. So now I'm gardening. So you're really muscle for gardening. But bearing witness for the true light. And I didn't know what light she was under until we started discussing different things. Until she started poking really at why you know, just question. Really question, if you're really talking to somebody, ask them to question things in their own life. Not question God's word, but question things in their own life and give them little things to really think about. I remember different discussions that we had, and I was filled with that, or just upsetness, or just different things that I couldn't explain, but I was not mad at her. I was more mad at, I think it was myself and my soul maybe turning and flipping, and it was more of, I do need to question these things. I do need to see where it goes farther. And I don't know, I mean, my spirit came to church, and I was a pastor's Sunday school, and downstairs in First Bible. He could have been preaching something completely different, but touched on different things of hell. I think he was going through different parts of hell or different, and it was so eye-opening there, and it kind of, you know, now you know where you're going to go when you die. Now what are you going to do about it? And it took 4 or 6 months after I was given the gospel to actually accept Jesus Christ as my Savior, to actually, you know, take the time and say, you know what, I'm going to go with Pastor, and I'm going to sit down, and we're going to really have this. Myself and Pastor Benson sat down, and we really went over it. He called me for a coffee, but there was no coffee there. So I was like, where's the coffee? But that day I know I trusted him as my Savior. After that, it was all the races. It was, not knowing after, actually my spiritual birthday is coming up on the 15th of this month. And I never knew, I never thought at year one, two, or three that I was going to be up in front of the congregation preaching or even teaching to other believers. And, it's not of me, but it's of God. And I'm trying to bear that witness to others. And by doing that, you need to be filled with the Holy Spirit. You need to be filled with that, and you need to be reading as well. I just love the title of it. It's God's simple plan of salvation. It's simple. It's not hard. It's not complex. It's not, you have to pray five times a day in order to do this, and you have to face this way. I understand I'm picking on the Muslims, but, it's very constrictive. Or even where I came from, the Catholic religion, is that, you have to go to this father if you committed a sin. My big one was disobeying my mom or lying to her. Those were big things that I would have to go to confession for and tell this man what I did, and then I would have to fake repetition of Our Father, our Hail Mary. Mm-hmm. What did it do after that? I never really learned. It never really pricked me to change what I was. But when I read and when I get into it, when I do actually feel the conviction of the Holy Ghost and what I'm doing is wrong, I'm feeling that change. I want to repent of that. I want to turn from where I was, turn and go the correct way. Do that 180 degree turn. So another way we do it with the gospel tract is that we actually go street preaching. This church is about going out and evangelizing and going to different events or different towns around the state and actually going out on the street and witnessing. And actually putting your foot down and saying, you're either going to heaven or hell. Where do you think you're going to spend eternity? And we're going to give you the remedy so that you don't have to go to hell. But a lot of people go by and scream, I'm going to hell. I hope to God you don't. Because I've been burned many times. I've been, cut or, smashed a finger or whatever. If that's just a fifth of what actually hell is, I don't want you to go there. As bad as my one man says, yes, I want you to go there. That's natural man. But my spiritual man says, hey, I actually really do want you to go to heaven. I don't want to see you burn forever. I don't want to see, I really don't. I'm not the judge. He's the judge. God's the ultimate judge. And I don't have the mind of him. Thank God I don't. I wish I'm truly reading through and that you want to get more of it. That we do want to strive after his mind. Just quickly turn to Ephesians 6. I've been there many times. But when we do street preach, as I did mention this last time I was up about the sword, is that this is the whole armor of God. Ephesians 19 and 20. Read quickly. We have a couple more minutes. And for me, that utterance may be given unto me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel. So we know what the gospel is. It's not a mystery. But to those people, it is a mystery. For which I am an ambassador in bonds, that therein I may speak boldly as I ought to speak. So he's giving you the whole armor beforehand in the previous verses, but he's also telling you that you can speak boldly. He doesn't have any armor for your mouth, he doesn't have any armor for your tongue, but you can speak boldly for him. So that you can give the gospel out and that you can preach it to your coworkers, to family members, to friends, to baby showers, gas pump, anywhere you want to give out the gospel, you can. And by using a tract or either opening your mouth or or see people think, oh, I'm just going to live this life, I'm just going to look all nice and, you know, go to work every day and actually do a good job, but it's actually putting the Bible on your desk or putting a scripture verse. You know? It's not just, it's living it. It's not just seeing it. It's not just doing it. So there's a couple more things I want to go through, but time's taken away. So, but I just want to give you things that you can use throughout this week for witnessing for the Lord, and I want to honor and glorify Him by just giving Him a little bit of my testimony, a little bit of the gospel as well, and just give a little bit of, you know, if you're at 50% of your battery, you know, now you're at 90% to give out that gospel. Now you have more thing in your armor so that you can give out that gospel. You can truly show that, you know, God is, you know, bear witness for that true life. Because we have that life. So please do.
Pretty cool. Amen.